Hey guys, sorry I'm not with you right now, but what I want you to actually do today is I want you to actually take a look at some of the issues that we have been looking at in class. And I want you to continue to be thinking about these things even though I'm not with you today. So to help you to do that, what I've actually got is I've got six films that I want you to take a look at. And they're all part of this video, so you just have to play it through. We've been looking at how different processes maintain ethnic diversity in and across the world. We looked at segregation, and we've been looking at some of the other processes as well, like multiculturalism and things like that. And what I want you to do today is, I know I said the last day that I wasn't going to talk about Belfast, but today we're going to talk about Belfast. And you probably haven't finished the notes yet, and that's okay, but I'm also going to give you out some stuff about Belfast, and hopefully this will help to put it in a bit more context in relation to the case study in relation to Belfast. And on Monday morning I'll take a bit of time and we'll look at this in a bit more detail. But what I want you to do today is to watch these videos and to think about how this maintains the diversity in Belfast. How have each of these different processes continued to keep the Protestants and the Catholics separate? How has it made sure that there has been no element of assimilation in Belfast? And that's what I want you to think about. I want you to think about how Belfast has continued to maintain ethnic diversity because of these different processes. If you've got any questions, I'm going to be working in my room most of the day, but if you want to come over at lunchtime or registration, I'll probably be able to talk to you a little bit more about any questions that you might have. But failing that, we'll spend a bit of time on Monday morning and we'll look at this in a fair amount of detail. I hope you enjoy these little videos. Manson out. Michael, concentrate.
The 18th century Belfast developed from the Castle Street, High Street area, up the Falls Road axis, main Catholic axis of Belfast, up the Shankill Road, the main Protestant axis, West Belfast, North Belfast, and then in East Belfast, which developed around the shipyards, we've got a mainly Protestant working class area, Ballymacarrat, but within it a small Catholic enclave, the Short Strand. There's a counterpart to that in West Belfast, which is predominantly Catholic, Falls Road, Glen Road, Andersonstown. Then in North Belfast, which is a patchwork of Protestant areas, Catholic areas, closely intermingled, you've got the Catholic Ardoyne area, divided from Upper Ardoyne or Glen Bryn by the Alliance Avenue. And up this road is the Holy Cross School that was the subject of demonstrations. And then in South Belfast, you've got Ballinafy, which is a mixed area, mixed Protestant and Catholic, mixed in terms of class, mixed in terms of students and more permanent residents and so forth. This area was the original heart of the city, Castle Street, High Street, and it developed mainly in the 19th century with industrialisation out from this core area. The Falls Road area developed from a small nucleus around a Catholic church, which was built in the 1780s with support from the local Presbyterians, who went on to help establish the United Irishmen. They were very radical at that point in time. From this developed the main Catholic sector of the city, which developed out from the centre, up Divis Street and up the Falls Road. Here we've got the Shankill Road and the Falls Road, Falls area, Springfield Road, and joining them is Lanark Way, which has got a big gate in the middle, and the gate was closed for during most of the Troubles, and there's a peace wall separating the Shankill area from the Falls area, so-called peace wall. This is predominantly Protestant East Belfast, Newtownards Road here, a lot of very elaborate murals along here, but in this area is the small Catholic enclave of Short Strand, separated by a so-called peace wall running along one side of Bryson Street, cutting off Madrid Street with a gate, cutting through Lewin Place, which is Loyalist, from the Nationalist Short Strand area, so very small, very sharply defined area of Short Strand. This is the Loyalist area of Donegal Pass. In recent years it's been dominated by the UVF. So in describing these areas, you've got to think sometimes in terms of which paramilitary group is dominant, not just whether or not they're loyalist. And across the Dublin Road and Bradbury Place, we've got Sandy Row, another traditional Protestant enclave, which traditionally were rivals, actually, of the Donegal Pass, so there was local rivalries within loyalism as well as between loyalists and nationalists. This is the Ardoyne Catholic Nationalist Enclave in North Belfast, with Alliance Avenue the main dividing line. There's a peace wall running behind the backs of these houses right the way up here, dividing loyalists from nationalists. The Holy Cross School is here, Holy Cross Primary School for girls, and the Catholic girls attending this primary school had to walk up this road to school, and they had to run the gauntlet from Alliance Avenue all the way up to the school. They could have gone a long way round, but their traditional way of going to school was the shortest route, and it also became a matter of principle that they had the right to walk on the road up here. At the moment, the conventional wisdom is that segregation is getting worse. In fact, we've found from looking at the actual data that it is not necessarily getting worse and worse. Some areas are, but some areas aren't. Some areas are getting better in terms of mixing and less conflict. And in the area of employment, there's less segregation than there used to be. There's a sense in which the territorial borders within Belfast, between loyalist working class areas and nationalist working class areas, act as a proxy for the national border between Northern Ireland and the Irish Republic.
People can't do much about the border between Northern Ireland and the Irish Republic, but they can do something, or they feel they can do something about the border at the end of their street. And territory becomes of symbolic importance. And territory lends itself to the zero-sum game that's typical of national conflicts. There is only a finite amount of territory. More for you means less for me. So that fits into the mindset of the people directly involved in these conflicts, zero-sum thinking. So the urban borders are both, in a sense, a proxy for the national border. You can try and extend your territory in Belfast or defend your territory in Belfast as a proxy, and it fits in with the idea of territory as being finite, subject to zero-sum thinking. Both loyalists and nationalists are quite capable of racist attitudes. On the loyalist side, there are some connections with racist groups from Britain. The far right in Britain has made some inroads into loyalism here in Belfast. The nationalists tend to identify themselves with the oppressed peoples of the world. They see their struggle as having some similarities with third world anti-colonial struggles. Another difference is that the majority of incoming migrants in low-paid jobs end up living in loyalist areas for the simple reason that there are more empty houses in loyalist areas because of the differential suburbanisation. More Protestant working class people have been decentralised to new housing estates on the outskirts, leaving more space available. And therefore, there are more likely to be people of African and Asian origin in loyalist working class areas than in Catholic ones. Some people interpret attacks on immigrants purely as racism. Others say that it is also bound up with loyalist paramilitary control of areas, that any new people coming in are seen as a threat by the paramilitaries. They might not know that you don't go and complain to the police, for instance. They may not know the rules of the game, and hence they may be seen as a threat by the paramilitaries to their control of these local areas.
You can try, 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 you can living. Got to have a believing. Got to have a believing. All the people, cause the people are leaving. When the people believe in. When the people believe in. When the people believe in. All the children, cause the children are leaving.
Thank you. Violence, so-called peace line, the walls of various forms and sizes, that separate what they call interfaith areas, places where Catholic and Protestant states intersect. The idea is that they stop missile attacks on homes and make residents feel safer. The walls started to be built as trouble flared in the late 60s, and today remain physical reminders that despite the progress of the peace process, there is still a way to go.
Here we live beside one of those peace walls. It's a natural. Living every day on the threat and fear.
To reflect on what they've just seen. I really don't mind the peace walls anymore. I've come to live with it.
There's no such thing as temporary peaceland. Peaceland's a variable compartment.
What function does the peaceland now fulfill? It's now the time to take it away.
The way I see it, we'll have a choice. We can live next to each other as enemies, or else we can live beside each other as neighbours. The presence of the wall will tell you the answer. It really is a barrier to peace.
You can actually see the loyalist houses on the far side of the fence here. On one afternoon, you know, this area wasn't expecting this. There would have been bombs come over here, there would have been shooting, there would have been ratting. And that really kicked off or commenced or began a whole 6 month period of conflict.
The violence broke out in 2002 in Shortstrand, a Catholic enclave in a Protestant zone. It was the most deadly since the peace accords were signed in Belfast on April 10, 1998. Afterwards, the calm returned to Shortstrand, but the locals still held their loyalties to the Irish Republican Army, which for 30 years has fought British and Unionist militias. The two communities live parallel lives, separated by what are called peace walls. Margaret doesn't like them. They divide people and foster hatred. She wants to see them demolished, but admits that it's still too early.
There's peace on our side. There's paramilitaries on their side haven't given their guns up yet. And I think maybe that's the reason why we wouldn't feel comfortable with that wall coming down at the moment.
A few meters from here on the other side of the wall, it's another world, another kind of fear, and of course another version of the story.
In 2002, some 6 years ago, violent Republicans from across that wall, that peace line, they were responsible for shooting and injuring five local people here from the Unionist community.
John isn't an extremist. On the contrary, he's a very moderate Unionist, one of the few in the community who sought out ties with Republicans before the ceasefire.
We have two irreconcilable ideologies here in Northern Ireland. There is, however, scope for conflict transformation, and that means to transform what was formerly an armed struggle to a democratic debate and discussion.
4,000 people died in the fighting. Older people suffered too much in the conflict to really believe in the peace. Reconciliation may only come now with new generations.
And you said you have probably some friends?
Yeah.
Yeah? We are good friends?
Not really close, like, but I have them.
And you could have a boyfriend, you have a son?
Yeah. No, I don't, but you can't have one.
The peace will grow up with the kids, but in the meantime, it's these separation walls that grow. Northern Ireland currently has 34 of them. That's 16 more than in 1998.
Hear me, boy.
I lean in North Island.
Check this. ISIS, my main woman, Sue Ramsey. She'd be a member of the Assembly of Sinn Féin. Now, Sinn Féin, what's the vibe?
Sinn Féin is a 32-county party. Our main aim is the reunification of Ireland.
And what is the language that they speak here?
They speak Gaelic here.
Gaelic?
Gaelic, yeah.
What is that, like a batty language or something? Like, what's the real name for it? What is it? It's called Irish.
Irish, yes.
So then when they're cussing it, they say it's like a gay man.
Gaelic means Irish in Irish.
Aye. Because in English, gay means a man who sleeps with another man. And a lick is like, you know. Is maybe the cause of the problem that they say that, and maybe it's a stereotype or whatever, but they say the Irish is always up for the crack or whatever. Is that a problem because the crack makes you violent? Me know people from me estate, they go mental and whenever there's someone around, they want to fight them, whatever.
No.
It's a bad drug.
No, crack in Ireland means having a good time.
For real, they ain't all fun. It's also bad stuff as well. There's a high, but after you finish it, there's
no,
a low.
Crack in Ireland is dangerous. Ali in Ireland, Ali in Northern Ireland.
Ali in Ireland, Ali in Northern Ireland. Boom! Wicked. I is with none other than my main man, the Lord Mayor of Ireland, David Alderife. And we is having a cup of tea.
Hello, Alex. You're very welcome to Belfast.
I don't know what's going on here. Why is there all the fighting?
There are people in Northern Ireland who wish to be part of the United Ireland.
For real.
And then there are people living in Northern Ireland who wish to remain part of the United Kingdom.
And where does Wogan stand?
Who, sorry?
Wogan.
Harry Wogan.
Harry Wogan.
I have no idea what his political stance is.
But was he not in the IRA?
Harry Wogan? No. No. I
lean in off island, I lean in off island.
Goodbye now. I lean in off island, I lean in off island. Boom! I is here now with my main man, Sammy Wilson, MB from the DUP, that me and the Democrat Party or something. So is you Irish?
No, I'm British.
So is you here on holiday?
No, Northern Ireland has always been part of Britain.
So why is everyone cussing the RAC?
Well, I think it's the RAC. the Royal Ulster.
They are AC people. Everyone today is saying they are AC. They've chucked stones at them and whatever. No. And it ain't their fault if they don't come, you know, in time or whatever.
Not everyone is doing that. You know, I think that's the first thing. The vast majority of people in Northern Ireland actually use the police. For their own protection.
But why is they using a breakdown service as police? That to me sounds like the most stupid thing. No wonder they're fighting here or whatever if they're doing that.
See, I think you've got a mistake. It's the RUC.
Goodbye now. Which is the biggest city in Ireland?
Which is the biggest city in Ireland?
Dublin, because it keeps on doubling and doubling in size. Have you got any jokes?
Well, there's a joke that's often told about Ian Paisley.
Aye.
And
that he is on crack.
He was swimming across the.
Is he on crack?
No, he's not. But he was faced with a river infested with crocodiles.
Aye.
And before he got in, he got this T-shirt with "I love the Pope" written on the back of it. And he swam across, and he got it right away to the other side. And they asked, "How did you get so far without the crocodiles getting?" And he says, "The crocodiles never swallow that."
Is the Pope a Catholic?
Ali in Ireland, Ali in Northern Ireland, Ali in Ireland, Ali in Northern Ireland. Boom!
Booyakasha. Check this. I was with George Patton. He'd be the chief executive of the Grand Orange Lodge of Ireland. Wicked. So let's talk about this march. What is this march that everyone banging on about?
Yeah, that's a good question, because we don't see the fuss sometimes.
Do you have music at this march?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, lots of music.
Oh, really?
The whole world.
Do you have drums?
We have drums, yep.
And is you like knocking out a drum and bass thing, or is it more kind of speed garage that you're knocking out?
It's all there. Different drummers have their own rhythms. It's an individual thing.
Do you not think, though, me not giving advice, but me saying from my own experience, sometimes it's good to back up the drums with a bit of human beatbox?
Yeah.
Do you not think that would be good?
Yes, of course it would.
But if someone was doing the, you know... people could chill from both sides and get into that.
I hope that people could.
Ali in Ireland,